الحمد لله الذي أرسل رسله بالبينات وأيدهم بالمعجزات الظاهرات. أحمده تعالى وأشكره وأتوب إليه وأستغفره، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، أكرمنا ببعثة سيد المرسلين، وجعلنا من خير أمة أخرجت للعالمين، وأشهد أن نبينا وحبيبنا وسندنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله، خاتم المرسلين وإمام المتقين، سيد ولد آدم أجمعين، وذحل الأمة الشرائع والأحكام، وبين لها الحلال من الحرام، هداها إلى سبيل الخيرات، وسن لها طرق الصلاح والبركات، وتركها على المحجة البيضاء الذي لا يزيغ عنها إلا أهل البدع والمحدثات. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أولو الفضل والمكرمات والتابعين لهم بإحسان ما دامت الأرض والسماوات. وقال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد: والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم تراهم ركعا سجدا يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود ذلك مثلهم في التوراة ومثلهم في الإنجيل كزرع أخرج شتأه فآزره فاستغلد فاستوى على سوقه يعجب الزراع ليغيظ بهم الكفار صدق الله العظيم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إذا ظهر الفتن والبدع والفساد وصبت أصحابي فليدحل العالم علمه، ومن لم يفعل ذلك فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. وفي رواية: إذا ظهر البدع وسكت العالم فعليه لعنة الله، أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا انك انت العليم الحكيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله. It's very nice to be back once again to talk about the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I just want to mention that what a privilege it is to talk about the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But even better, what a privilege it is to listen to the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to listen to their life and the virtues regarding them that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned. Inshallah, today the companion that we're going to be talking about, his name is Tufail ibn Amr ad-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala an. Now Hazrat Tufail radiallahu ta'ala an, he was from a very well-known, a very noble and respected and a very rich family. And he himself, alhamdulillah, he was also very well known in Arabia for his poetry and his intelligence and his generosity. And because of this, all through Arabia, his excellence and his fame had spread. Now, if the people of Arabia, they would say about him that لا تنزل قدر عن ناره ولا يوسد له باب أمام طارق يدعم الجائع ويؤمن الخائف ويجير المستجير. The people of Arabia, they would say about him that he is so generous that his pot of food, it never comes off the stove, because continuously he would keep feeding people. Mehman, guests would come to his house, and all the time his pot would stay on the fire, keeping the food warm for people to come and eat. وَلَا يُوسَدُ لَهُ بَابٌ أَمَامَ طَارِقٍ. And it would be said that his door would never be shut to a person who would come at night asking for a room to sleep in. وَيُدْعِمُ الْجَاعِيَةِ. He would go around and he would feed hungry people. وَيُؤَمِّنُ الْخَائِفَ. Subhanallah, he was so polite that they knew him as a person who would console and comfort people that were fearful and terrorized. وَيُجِيرُ الْمُسْتَجِيدِ. And those people that would ask for refuge, he would give these people refuge. Now, like I had said, he was a very famous poet in Arabia. And what he would do is, from time to time, he would frequent Makkah, especially on the occasion of Ukaz. Ukaz, it was a festival that would be held, and All the poets from around Makkah al-Mukarramah, they would attend this in Makkah al-Mukarramah near the Ka'batullah, and they would compete in their poetry. Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala, he was one of those poets that would compete in the forefront. Now, like I said, he would frequent Makkah al-Mukarramah even times other than the season and the festival of Ukaz. So one day he decided that he's going to visit Makkah al-Mukarramah. Now, this was at a time just after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had returned from the famous journey of Taif, which is very well known, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he went to a place called Taif and he met the three chieftains. These people, they rejected what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they refuted him. And after rejecting what he had said, they instructed the people of the markets and the streets to stone Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he returned from this famous journey. This is when Tufail ibn Amr radiallahu ta'ala, he decided that he would carry out a journey to Makkah al-Mukarramah. So the news, it reached Makkah al-Mukarramah and the people of Quraysh, that Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi, he set out to Makkah. Now, these people, they were shaken, because they sort of knew that if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he gets to Tufail ibn Amr before us, Tufail ibn Amr being a very famous poet, he would, after listening to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he will definitely be taken back and accept what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says. So these people, they prepared a warm welcome for Tufail, and what they had done is they went outside of Makkah al-Mukarramah to embrace him. When Hazrat Tufail radiyallahu ta'ala, he reached Makkah al-Mukarramah, these people, they embraced him. They gave him a nice warm welcome, and you can just imagine what would have been included in this warm welcome. There was food, wine, women were there, there was music going on. After embracing him and greeting him and giving him the warm welcome, they began telling him about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that a man has arisen amongst us and he has caused such havoc and chaos amongst the city of Makkah and these people. And his speech is like magic. As in, the effect that magic has is the same effect his speech has got. The effect of magic is it'll cause enmity and hatred between a husband and a wife, a son and a father, a mother and her daughter. So his speech has got this similar effect. So they warned Hazrat Tufail ibn Amr radiallahu ta'ala to stay away from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hazrat Tufail radiallahu ta'ala, he says himself that these people, they had instilled such fear inside my heart that I began walking on the streets of Makkah al-Mukarramah with pieces of cloth inside my ears. To such an extent that the people of Makkah, they began calling him Dhul-Qitanayn, a person with pieces of cloth in his two ears. So he says, by coincidence, one day I enter the Haram, and what do I see? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in front of the Kaaba and he's praying Salah. So he says that I went and stood next to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Despite having pieces of cloth inside my ears, he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rejected that I don't hear anything. And it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that reached the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to my ears. He says, what I heard, I found it totally fine. It was a fine speech. There was nothing wrong with it. I didn't hear any fault inside it. I didn't hear any faults. There was no sort of abusive language. There was nothing wrong with it. What I heard was a fine speech. So he says that I sat down and I began thinking to myself that I am a professional poet. I'm a professional poet, and if I listen to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has got to say, I'm sure if there is any false in there, it will stay hidden from me. So he says that I sat with Rasulullah, next to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and when he finished his salah, I walked behind him towards his house. Just before he entered his house, I said that, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, your people have prevented me from listening to your speech, and they've instilled such fear inside me that I have begun putting pieces of cloth in my ears. But today what I heard a fine speech. Please present your religion to me. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he began telling Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala about Islam. And then after this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he recited two or three surahs. Surah Ikhlas, Surah Falaq, and Surah An-Nas. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ أَنْ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. When Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala, he heard the surahs and he heard what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had to say about Islam, immediately there and then he exclaimed that wallahi I have never heard such a beautiful speech and I have never heard of such a moderate religion than Islam. And on the spot there and then he said the shahada, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan rasulullah. Now after this he stayed with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a short while, and in this short while that he stayed with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he learned all those verses that had come down until then and the rulings that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had established until then. Now after this short while that he had stayed with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one day he came and he said that, ya Rasulullah, inni imra'un muta'un fi ashirati. He said, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I am a person who is listened to, as in people listen to me in my tribe and amongst my people and inside my family. وَأَنَا رَاجِعٌ إِلَيْهِمْ وَدَاعِيهِمْ إِلَى الْإِسْلَامِ. He says that, ya Rasulullah, I am going to return back to these people and I want to call them towards Islam. فَادْعُوا اللَّهَ أَنْ يَجْعَلَ لِي آيَةً تَكُونُ عَوْنًا فِي مَا أَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ. He said that, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes some sort of a sign that will be a help for me to call these people towards Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he done a dua for him, he prayed for him and he said, Allahumma ja'allahu ayah, that, oh Allah, make a sign for him. Anyway, after this, he sets off and he's going now towards his village where his people were, his family were, his father, mother and his wife. He says that when I got close to the village, I realized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created a small light upon my forehead, which is shining like a lamp. So he fears, thinking about his people, he fears that if I go back to these people with this light on my forehead, they may think that this is a punishment for leaving the religion of my forefathers. So he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, I fear that these people may think it is a punishment for leaving the deen and leaving the religion of my forefathers. And he says that, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, take this away and put it somewhere else. So after a short while, he realizes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has transferred the light from his forehead to his stuff. Like this, he enters the village and he sees, the first person he sees is, he sees his father coming with his arms open to welcome him. But Allahu Akbar, you know, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were ready to give up anything for the deen of Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He sees his father and he says to his father that, please stay away. Oh father, please stay away. A connection no longer remains between me and you. His father, stricken by shock, he says to him that, what is this that you're saying? He says to him that, father, I have become a Muslim. I have accepted the religion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there and then he put guidance into the heart of the father. His father says to him that, whatever religion you are on to fail, even I am on that religion. He says to his father, fine, go and have a bus so that I may teach you the religion, the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After this, the second person he sees is his wife. Again, his wife coming with arms open to embrace him and greet him. He says the same thing to her, that please stay away. No connection remains between me and you any longer. His wife, again, stricken with shock, she says, what's this you're saying? He says to her that, I have become a Muslim. I have accepted the religion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, he gives her guidance. She there and then on the spot, she says that, I also am on the religion that you are on. So he sends her also to do ghusl, to have a bath, so that he may teach them the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now after this, he begins his mission and he goes out to call the people of those. But nobody is listening to him apart from one person, Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala, who was another companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and also known as the Muhaddis of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. So there's only two, and the father and the mother. These are the only people until now they've embraced Islam upon the hands of Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi. After this, he keeps striving and keeps making effort in calling people, but nobody is listening to him. So one day, him and Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala, they both go back to Madinatul Munawwara to complain to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that, ya Rasulullah, these people, they are not accepting. When they reach Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's expecting Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi to bring his tribe back, to bring his family back. But seeing him with one person, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he shocked. So he says to him that, Tufail, what's this? He says, ya Rasulullah, قُلُوبٌ عَلَيْهَا أَكِنَّ وَكُفْرٌ شَدِيدٌ لَقَدْ غَلَبَ عَلَى دَوْسَ الْفِسْقُ وَالْعِسْيَانِ. He says, ya Rasulullah, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these people, قُلُوبٌ عَلَيْهَا أَكِنَّ, these people, their hearts have locks upon them. وكفرا شديدا they indulged in severe كفر لقد غلب على دوس الفسق والعصيان he said يا رسول الله these people transgression and sin has overpowered these people and then he asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam please make dua for these people please pray for their people so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam he lifts his hands Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala in one narration he says that when I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lifting his hands he says that I feared for my tribe and my people because I thought Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to pray against them but what was the prayer of Rasulullah he said Allahumma hdi dawsan wa'ti bihim that oh Allah guide dawsa and bring them then he turned round to Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala and he said to him that irji' warfaq bihim wad'uhum ila al-islam that return back to them and be soft with them call them politely and call them nicely show them mercy and show them kindness and call them towards Islam now Tufail ibn Amr exactly like every other sahabi he goes back and he calls them according to the advice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam showing them mercy showing them softness showing them kindness showing them politeness he calls them and slowly they begin accepting Islam now the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the battle of badr has taken place the battle of uhud has also taken place and a short while after this Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam he migrates to Madinatul Munawwarah after his migration to Madinatul Munawwarah Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam He sees that Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala, he comes to Madinatul Munawwara. But this time when he enters Madinatul Munawwara, Allahu Akbar, he's got with him 80 families that have accepted Islam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is so overjoyed. He's so happy for him that some of the booty that was acquired in the Battle of Khaybar, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave him a share of this. Soon after this, he enters Makkah al-Mukarramah along with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam very very humbly glorifying and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this clear victory that Allah had given them now it's very famous that we know that when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Makkah al-Mukarramah the conquest of Makkah one of the things that he had done was broken all the idols in the Kaaba Now on seeing this, Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala, he asks permission from Rasulullah that Ya Rasulullah, give me permission to go and break and destroy the idol of Ammar ibn Humama, which was called Dhul-Kaffain. This was an idol that was worshipped by the tribe of Dawsi. So this really angered Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi. So he goes back, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives him permission and he goes back. When he goes back, he sees that some people, they are worshipping this idol. So in front of these people, Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala, he goes over to the idol and he knocks the idol down. After knocking the idol down, he sets the idol on fire. Now these people that are around watching, they are waiting for some sort of a punishment or some sort of a calamity to fall upon Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala. And whilst he's doing this, he's singing a poem and he's saying, Ya dhal kaffain lastu min ubbadi. The O Zulkafain, O idol, I am not from amongst those that worship you. Miladuna akhdamu miladik. Our birth was a long time before your birth. Inni hashawtu nara fi fuadi. That now I am filling you and setting you on fire. Seeing this, those people, the rest of the people who had not embraced Islam until yet, even those people, due to this action, when they saw this, that he's knocked the idol down and no calamity has befallen him. Seeing this, they realize that these are false gods and they say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Now, after this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he stays with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passes away. But he's got the ayat in his head, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا He has this ayat in his mind that Muhammad is nothing but a prophet. Basically, the deen it doesn't end with the death of a messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he carried his deen on even in the khilafat of Hazrat Abu Bakr. After the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he hands himself, he hands his sword, and he hands his own son, like every other Muslim sahabi radiallahu anhum, into the service of the rightly guided khalifa, Hazrat Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. One day, when Musaylamatul Kadhab, the fake, the liar, who claimed prophethood, when he arose, And he claimed that he was a prophet. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, he sent out an army to fight this person and to destroy him. Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala, he was one of those fortunate companions that was in this army that went to fight Musaylimah al-Kadhdhab. Now on the way, whilst they were there, when they were going, they stopped up at a certain station where they thought that they would rest for the night, and in the morning they'll proceed. During the night, Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala, he sees a dream. And in the dream he sees that his head has been shaven off. After the hair has been shaven off, he sees that a bird flies out of his mouth. And then after this, he sees that a woman has taken him into her belly. And then his son is going around looking for him. In the morning when he wakes up, he asks one of the other companions for an interpretation. And Allahu Akbar, they give him a beautiful interpretation. They say to him that your hair being shaven off is indicating that your head will be chopped off in the battle. The bird leaving your mouth is indicating that your soul will leave and you will attain shahad. The woman taking you into her belly is indicating that the earth, a grave will be dug and you will be put in the grave. As in, the earth will take you inside. And your son looking for you, searching for you, shows and is indicating that he will also follow your footsteps. As in, he will also gain shahadat, he will also gain martyrdom. Now, when the battle begins, Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala, Allahu Akbar, he shows great courage. He shows great courage, but suddenly, towards the end, the dream, it comes true, and he's martyred. And he got his soul leaves and meets with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, just before we end, I just want to draw your attention towards a few lessons that we can learn from the life of Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi radiallahu ta'ala. One of the first lessons is that through life we'll come across incidents, we'll come across stories. Our job is to listen to both sides of the story. This is a major lesson that we learn. That never listen to one side of the story, always listen to two sides of a story whenever an incident is presented in front of you. Exactly like Tufail ibn Amr radiallahu ta'ala, you don't. That when the mushrikeen, they prevented him, he went and he listened to the story of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The truth became evident itself. The second is that if a person, he enjoys a high rank amongst his society or amongst his people, or he knows himself that he is an influential personality amongst his society, then that influential personality or that high rank that he has, he should use that to call his people towards the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other thing that we learn from this is, subhanallah, the concern the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they had regarding their families and regarding their relatives and their friends. You'd see even Abu Zar al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala, as soon as he accepted Islam, one of the first things that he done was he went back and he called his tribe. Similarly, Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi and so many other Sahaba radiallahu anhum that inshallah we're going to be talking about, Allahu Akbar, one of the first things they do is go call their family. A major lesson that we learn is that if we are going towards success, if we are on the correct path, then one of the first things that we're supposed to be thinking about is our family. That is our family on the same path? Is our family going towards the same success that Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have told us about? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to act upon what has been said. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to call our families. And like I always pray, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrect us with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.